Preston, his extraordinary poetic account of relentless pursuit by God. But the life of this Victorian writer was just as extraordinary. Now, in a dramatised documentary, poet Michael Simmons-Roberts goes in search of the visionary behind The Hound of Heaven and finds himself in turn pursued by Thompson.
A few years ago, I was on a rail trip to Scotland with a friend. We had to change trains here at Preston Station, and I told her, with suitable gravitas, that this was my hometown. Where were you born, I asked her. Tehran, she said. Well, compared with Tehran, Preston may not be the most poetic birthplace, but as a Prestonian poet, I always enjoyed the thought that a wild Victorian visionary was born here too. Francis Thompson was a drug addict who lived rough on the streets of London. He lived life on the edge and over it, but from his tortured imagination came some remarkable poems, not least the famous Hound of Heaven, which describes a terrifying pursuit of man by God.
I fled him down the nights and down the days. I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the labyrinthine ways of my own mind. And in the mist of tears, I hid from him and under running laughter. Up vistaed hopes I sped and shot precipitated adown titanic glooms of chasmed fears from those strong feet that followed after.
He fled. He fled all his life. He fled his hometown. He fled his father. He fled his religious vocation. He fled medical school. He fled peace, sobriety, sanity, God.
But with unhurrying chase and unperturbed pace, deliberate speed, majestic instancy, they beat, and a voice beat, more instant than the feet. All things betray thee who betrayest me.
In this programme, I'm the pursuer on his trail, and the hunt for Francis Thompson will take me from a Manchester medical dissection room to a quiet monastic retreat and the very London streets he slept on. But it begins about a mile from here, where he was born, and so was I.
You won't find me here. A plaque on the wall's the best you'll find. A plaque on the wall that nobody reads.
Francis Thompson, poet, was born in this house, December the 16th, 1859. And there's a quotation from one of his poems, "Ever and anon a trumpet sounds from the hid battlements of eternity." It's slightly incongruous now, this plaque, on modern Winkley Street in Preston, which is rather chic, arcade, full of restaurants and flash shoe shops and sports cars parked alongside. It's hard to imagine it as a context in which this rather ascetic poet was born.
Ascetic? You think a hungry child is ascetic? You think I made an artistic choice to grow up in a famine? Some things are chosen, some things are given.
The Thompsons were pretty well off, actually. Francis' father was a doctor, a homeopath, but the poet was born in tough times. The American Civil War caused the cotton industry to dry up, devastating towns like Preston. The effects were felt by every family. Emma Heselwood's a historian from the Harris Museum in Preston.
The entire town suffered in terms of the market, traders, the doctors, the lawyers. Nobody had any money to spend. He would have seen poverty on a huge scale. There is another poet who visited Preston during that time called Edwin Vaughan, and he describes, families who were in hovels with no heating, no clothing, staring at the corner of the room where, you know, their husband or their father had just died. I mean, it was a horrible time, it really was.
There's no real trace of Francis left here. His family fled the cotton famine and went to live in Ashton, the other side of Manchester. But Francis left Ashton pretty swiftly. His devout Catholic parents thought the boy had a vocation, so they sent him away to become a priest.
His sister, his older sister, said Francis wanted to be a priest from a small boy. I think that's because he was fascinated by the liturgy and the rituals in their own church. Very different to the very sordid surroundings of living in the outskirts of Manchester at that time.
Bridget Boardman is Francis Thompson's biographer and editor of the most recent edition of his poems.
It was appeared that he would have a genuine vocation, and he was 6 years studying at Ashore College in Durham. And I think those years were very important for his poetry because he absorbed a great deal of the poetry and the beauty of the Catholic liturgy. And because Ashore College is set in the most beautiful surroundings in the hills of Durham, he linked this up very closely with the beauties of nature and the cycle of the natural world.
His fellow students thought he was a bit of an oddball, but they liked him and rechristened him Frank. But the authorities found him too vague, too attached to the poetry shelves in the college library. So he fled Ashore College, fled the priesthood.
I failed God. I failed my family. I failed myself.
Frank was sent to follow in Dad's footsteps, to train in medicine at Owens College, Manchester. So I pursued him there and found a Victorian lecture theatre intact, a polished wooden grandstand with rows of numbered seats bearing down on a table long enough to lay out a corpse for dissection. Dr. Stella Butler, head of special collections at the University of Manchester, told me the kind of things our reluctant medic would have seen during his training.
The emphasis in medical education was on morbid anatomy, of cutting up things, looking at pathological specimens in jars. I mean, it's all pretty gruesome. But also, I mean, the clinical practice at that time that he will have experienced in the neighbouring Manchester infirmary, he will have seen lots of TB, he will have seen lots of cancer, all sorts of things that he couldn't really offer very effective remedies for either.
So for a highly sensitive child who didn't really want to be a doctor anyway, this was a pretty grueling experience.
I think a recipe for depression, yes.
He was very close to his mother, and she died during these years he was at Owens College of a very painful disease for which opium was the only palliative at that time. And opium is also used in homeopathic medicine. So it would have been readily available, both in the college where he was studying medicine and also, of course, at home. So that knowing the soothing effects that it could have, I think that was when he started his addiction.
To fail medical exams once isn't unusual, but it takes a poet to fail them 3 times. Failed priest and now failed doctor, Francis fled his family and the north of England. He fled to the horror of the largest, darkest urban nightmare of its time, London. Addicted to opium, grieving for his mother, friendless and homeless, he found himself here, on the narrow, dark streets between Charing Cross and the River Thames. Bridget Boardman.
He was reduced to selling matches, calling cabs, the sort of things that people did who were at the very lowest strata of the very strict hierarchy of life on the London streets. Of course, the only relief that he could find from this life was through the fantasies that he could induce through opium. So anything he managed to earn went on the opium. And he still managed to save a few pennies to buy notebooks, penny notebooks, and indelible pencils, which would withstand the rain and the bad weather. And those notebooks, many of them, still exist. And it's very moving to handle those notebooks and to actually read the poems he was trying to write during those 3 whole years that he spent in this condition on the streets.
I don't know how I could fill up 6 notebooks by being on the street. Most of my time was spent trying to get something to eat.
Like Francis, Adrian has lived on the streets. He's become part of the Church of St. Martin in the Fields creative writing group for homeless people.
But you see, some of the danger comes from other people, other beggars and other street homeless people. They see that you're vulnerable and they'll try to rob you, or they will pester you to borrow money. Well, sadly, because of drugs and alcoholism and all kinds of things, it can be a, you know, more of a danger than the police or people who members of the public who've got contempt for you. And how did he, if he found time to write, he must have snuck away and gone to places, because, and if you read George Orwell, who was writing about being down and out in the 30s, people would have been suspicious of you if you'd have been writing things in a notebook. Might have thought you were a police spy or something like that.
There's a story that when Thompson hit the streets in London, he was picked up by one of the church wardens of St. Martin's, a man called John McMaster.
Nicholas Holtham is vicar of St. Martin's in the heart of Frank's Charing Cross.
And for a few months, McMaster took Thompson in and got him working, I think, and part of his household. And the relationship didn't last for very long, and I think it probably got to the point where McMaster threw him out. But certainly he was unable to sustain that. Of course, Thompson later wrote a poem, which sometimes it's remembered as The Kingdom of God or In No Strange Land. And it's got that fantastic line, halfway betwixt heaven and Charing Cross. And I think we think that that must have been a poem which referred back to St. Martin's and that sense of this being a meeting place of heaven and earth, halfway betwixt heaven and Charing Cross.
O world invisible, we view thee. O world intangible, we touch thee. O world unknowable, we knew thee. Inapprehensible, we clutch thee. Does the fish soar to find the ocean? The eagle plunge to find the air? That we cry to the stars in motion, if they have rumour of thee there. Not where the wheeling systems darken and our benumbed conceiving soars. The drift of pinions, would we hearken, beats at our own clay-shuttered doors. The angels keep their ancient places. Turn but a stone and start a wing. Tis ye, tis your estranged faces that miss the many splendid thing. But when so sad thou canst not sadder cry, and upon thy so sore loss shall shine the traffic of Jacob's ladder, pitched betwixt heaven and Charing Cross. Yea, in the night my soul, my daughter, cry, clinging to heaven by the hems, and lo, Christ walking on the water. Not of Gennesareth, but Thames.
When he'd been on the streets for 3 years and he was facing another winter, and these were in fact some of the coldest winters of the whole 19th century, he just felt he couldn't face any more. And he managed to save up enough to buy a massive dose of opium, which he intended to take and so end his misery. He took half of it, and on his way to some suitable place to take the final dose, he fell under a cab in a sort of dazed condition and was pulled out from underneath, literally, by a young woman who took him back to her lodgings, and she was a prostitute. And that started a relationship, the nature of which we don't know anything about. But it lasted for 6 months. The only thing we know about her, we don't even know her name, was that she appreciated Thompson's poetry and encouraged him to continue to write.
It wasn't just winter on the streets that drove Francis to attempt suicide. Earlier in the year, he'd hand-delivered a batch of poems to a literary journal called Merry England in the hope that they'd publish him. But the manuscript got lost in the magazine office, and Frank assumed that silence meant failure. Then the following spring, the manuscript turned up in an office clear-out. And the editor of Merry England, Wilfred Mennell, was amazed at the quality of the writing. He replied to the P.O. Box address left with the poems, but Frank had given up, moved on, was living with the girl who'd rescued him from suicide. So Wilfred Mennell published one of the poems in an attempt to flush out this mystery poet.
Dear Mr. Mennell, I'm informed that one of the verses I submitted to you has appeared in this month's issue of your magazine. I have no doubt that your explanation, when I receive it, will be entirely satisfactory to me. I enclose a stamped and addressed envelope for an answer, hoping you will recompense me for my long delay by the favour of an early reply.
The encounter between the influential editor and the homeless poet was life-changing for both of them. Frances spent more and more time with Wilfred Mennell and his wife Alice, a celebrated poet herself. Out of the tunnel of the long, dark years, a light was shining. The Mennells knew everyone who was anyone on the London literary scene, and Frank was becoming a celebrity.
Then she was gone. All her clothes had gone. Her tiny box of trinkets and keepsakes was gone. The smell of her perfume was gone. The rent was paid in full. There wasn't a note. No message was needed. I knew why she'd left. For me. She did it for me.
The prostitute, whose name we'll never know, who rescued Frank and nurtured him, who kept him writing in his darkest days, now vanished, just as his life was coming together. She was afraid she would damage his reputation and his burgeoning career, but he couldn't let her go.
We lay in sleep, I think in sleep, together, she and I, and each were conscious in our sleep of the other's breathing nigh. What came of it? The touch of lip in dream, the twine of arms, the lock of wills. These things are dim and slip our memories since we woke. None knows, nor she nor I.
The Mennells took Frank in and gave him work on their journal, Merry England. But they'd taken on a tough challenge. His addiction to opium was at its height after those years on the streets, so they sent him to Storrington Priory in Sussex. Here, they hoped, he could break his addiction and write.
Most of the canons spoke French, if they spoke at all, so my friends were the village kids. I could talk to them. And then, the poetry was gifted back to me. I wrote a verse here called Daisy for one little girl. Saw the sun set over the ridge and wrote an ode to it. And I began playing with ideas for a long poem. The Hound of Heaven. I said to dawn, be sudden, to eve, be soon. With thy young sky blossoms, heap me over from this tremendous lover. Float thy vague veil about me, lest he see. I tempted all his servitors, but to find my own betrayal in their constancy, in faith to him, their fickleness to me, their traitorous trueness, and their loyal deceit.
The Hound of Heaven, I'm not even certain who he is. That the eye of the poem is fleeing. I fled him.
Valentine Cunningham is Professor of English at Oxford and has included several of Frank's poems in his recent anthology of Victorian poetry.
What kind of deity or spirit or angel or devil or combination of all of these haunting kind of figures? Who is it? And, of course, it turns very quickly into what really interests Thompson, namely a poem essentially about eroticism.
Naked I wait thy love's uplifted stroke. My harness, piece by piece, thou hast hewn from me and smitten me to my knee. I am defenseless, utterly.
But it's that kind of rush and confusion and mist and fog of desire and fear and anticipation and so on, which I suspect is the attraction of that poem to this day. If it has attractions, that's what it is. And it ain't specially Christian at all. Certainly not theological.
Whom wilt thou find to love ignoble thee? Save me. Save only me. All which I took from thee I did but take, not for thy harms, but just that thou might seek it in my arms. All which thy child's mistake fancies as lost, I have stored for thee at home. Rise, clasp my hand, and come. Halts by me that footfall. Is my gloom, after all, shade of his hand, outstretched caressingly? Ah, fondest, blindest, weakest, I am he whom thou seekest. Thou dravest love from thee, who dravest me.
I wonder what you'd think, Francis, of the fact that your notebooks, your precious notebooks, have become relics, and I've now got to wear white cloth gloves to handle them. They are extraordinary. This one, full of elaborate pencil note-taking and tightly packed numbered pages. Here, in the middle of the notebook, is what seems to be early notes towards the Hound of Heaven. The imagery is certainly the same. Sounds down. He's got down as an alternative to in. Down in archways of my heart, and tears are all I write with. And include some quite personal, some quite revealing moments. I have a malady which sets us apart, you modern reader who do not read me. I have a malady of thought, I must think. You hate to think, hate to concentrate, hate to attend. I make you do all these things if you read me. Well, we agree. You agree not to read me. I agree not to be read by you. Would you desire better agreement?
So you found me. You found me in those black-bound notebooks. That's the closest you'll get. Drafts of new poems, redrafts of old ones. Limericks, jokes, thoughts, dreams, rants, lists of Lancashire cricket teams. Touch this pencil tracery, and you almost touch me.
From the moment the Menals plucked him from the streets and from obscurity, the great dramas of Frank's life settled to a new equilibrium. He focused on his poetry, writing book reviews to pay the bills. With the Menals' help, he stayed off the street, but he couldn't stay off the opium. They sent him to North Wales for an extended detox, but his health declined steeply, and he died of tuberculosis in 1907, at the age of just 48.
I told them, and I'll tell you, it wasn't TB, it was beriberi, malnutrition. Trust me, I was almost a doctor. It was years of subsisting on pork pies and tobacco that did it, not TB. I told them at the hospital, but they wouldn't listen. They were more concerned with the opium powder they found hidden in my shoes.
He died in the hospital, St. John and Elizabeth, which is a Catholic hospital in London, by himself. There was nobody present. In the early morning in November, and I think the only people at his funeral were probably the Menal family and a few close friends. And he was buried in the Catholic cemetery at Kensal Green, because it's a rather a lovely tomb, actually. It's quite big, it's sort of raised up one, and it has a line from, it's the last line of the poem he wrote to his godson, who was also Francis.
Look for me in the nurseries of heaven.
So when they meet eventually in heaven, it won't be all among the patriarchs and the great saints and the big people. Look for me in the nurseries of heaven.
Francis Thompson wrote for us. He firmly believed that a future age would value him more highly than his own. In a way, he got his wish. The Hound of Heaven is still a well-known poem, or at least a well-known title. The pressures of his life almost overpowered his work, and in some of his writing, the opium is as much the author as he is. But at its best, he seems to me to be a brave and single-minded visionary, a wild mystic poet from Preston. I'll leave the last word on Frank's literary legacy to Professor Valentine Cunningham of Oxford University.
It's a shame that he's not known more for the detail of his best verses. Namely the poem To a Snowflake, which I think is one of the finest, if you like, romantic Victorian poems about a piece of nature. You can imagine him, as it were, watching the snowfall and feeling pretty awful, but meditating on the beauty of this thing, which is so unlike the ugliness of his own existence, messed about, drug-taking, all the rest of it. What heart could have thought you, past our devisal, O filigree petal?
Fashioned so purely, fragilely, surely, from what paradisal imagineless metal, too costly for cost? Who hammered you, wrought you from Argentine vapour? God was my shaper. Passing surmisal, he hammered, he wrought me, from curled silver vapour to lust of his mind. Thou couldst not have thought me, so purely, so palely, tinily, surely, mightily, frailly, insculped and embossed, with his hammer of wind and his graver of frost.
The Hound of Heaven was written and presented by Michael Simmons-Roberts. Francis Thompson was played by Ken Bradshaw. And the programme was produced in Wales by Jeremy Grange.